all of you for coming and making this event a great success. I would also like to thank our co-sponsors of this evening event, Campus Climate Action Group, Center for Multicultural and International Affairs, Music Department, and Student Involvement and Leadership. I would also like to thank our administrators, Board of Trustees, faculty, students, and the community for making this and helping us put together an evening with event. I know that April is really a busy month. We are trying to catch up with everything before the semester ends. I really appreciate all of you coming here, and I can assure you that it will be a great event. I would like to also thank many of the staff members who have helped us to make this evening come together. Of course, musicians who decided to come and play at Bitwater. As we cannot go around the world, we are bringing world-renowned musicians right at Bitwater to you. To begin with, today we are going to have, as Prof. Santos gave the idea, Symphony Star. First, we are going to have a presentation of African-American composers in classical music. If you ask any of Henry's students who go to Summer Piano Institute, they would name some of the African-American composers in Western classical music. As much as I got educated because of that, I would like to share that with you. Take a moment and think about who you can think for African-American composers in the Western classical music. And today we are all going to get educated, and there will be a 20-minute presentation and demonstration of particularly African-American composers. This is one of the events that we hope is just the beginning, because in Bridgewater State College, we are bringing the Center for Performing Arts for the region. Hopefully, events like this will bring us to make our dreams come true. And first is Prof. Henry Santos doing a presentation, and at 8 o'clock it will be followed by first time jazz and world music together, and the musicians haven't met each other with different types of music. You'll be the first audience to see what they can put together with inspiration. And as you all know, Professor Henry Santos, I don't think he needs any introduction. I'll let him talk about this, so I won't take much time from that.
Thank you, Dr. Tom. It's a pleasure to be here, and tonight, it's not that I'm playing so much, is that such a prestige of my caliber, composers, musicians, poets, scholars, people who are in the milieu of creating, whether it's in terms of knowledge or hand or heart. And there's one person that I'd like to give you a little biography before I play a movement of his symphony, because it's very important. His name is William Grant Still. And William Grant Still was the first person of color to employ the blues in a symphonic form. And his story was one of trial, of great promise, and great realization. And I just would like to share with you a little of his biography, surround him with the Harlem Renaissance, of which he was a great part, and then play a first movement of his symphony that received wide acclaim during that time. William Grant Still was born in Woodville, Mississippi in 1895. Still moved with his mother to Little Rock, Arkansas, shortly after the death of his father, to live with relatives. His grandmother's singing of spirituals and opera records of his stepfather instilled a great love of music. He went to Wilberforce University to study medicine, but there, instead of a career in music, he formed a string quartet, tried conducting, and experimented with performance on various instruments. In 1916, he began his association with W.C. Handy. Now, I know I have quite a age spread here, but W.C. Handy should say to some of the, shall we say, older of the generations here, will remember his composition, St. Louis Blues. Anyway, Wynn Grantstill spent time with him. Then he went to Oberlin College, studied music, and returned and was discharged from the Navy. He studied during this time afterwards with George Chadwick, who was the president of the New England Conservatory, who was a noted American composer at the time, and also Edgar Varese of New York, both of whom refused to accept payment for his studying. Prior to the premiere of his first symphony by Howard Hanson, composer and president of Eastman School of Music, he had worked as an arranger and composer for Artie Shaw, Sophie Tucker, Paul White, and he was later to write for films like Pennies from Heaven and the television series Gunsmoke and Perry Mason. He moved to Los Angeles and for more than four decades wrote operas, orchestral music, vocal, keyboard, and chamber works in large numbers. This was the first symphony written by a black American composer, and it's called Afro-American Symphony. And in many ways, this work satisfied the aspirations of the Harlem Renaissance through the elevation of the ethnic heritage. Still came to maturity during the early years of the Harlem Renaissance and was geographically located in the midst of New York City. The Harlem Renaissance is conventionally perceived as a literary movement and began towards the end of World War I and flourished during the 1920s and 30s. In The New Negro, a collection of essays, poetry, and graphic art edited by Aline Locke, a professor of philosophy at Howard University in 1925, this work served as a cultural manifesto expressing the aspirations and visions of the movement. Locke took an interest in these compositions and listed them in the bibliography of Negro music in The New Negro. He recognized Still's importance as one of the few African-American art music composers and as someone who could contribute to his program for the promotion of American-African culture and race relations. Still turned to sources other than jazz or the spirituals. In the Afro-American Symphony, composed in New York City in 1930, Still turned to the blues, explaining, "I wanted to prove conclusively that the Negro musical idiom is an important part of the world's music culture. This was the reason I decided to create a musical theme in the blues idiom and develop it into the highest of forms, the symphony." Still had extensive experience with the blues during his time with W.C. Handy, and the first theme of the Afro-American Symphony displays prime characteristics of the blues scale, the lower third, the seventh, and also a falling melodic contour and call and response. I'd like to do this on the piano, if you just permit me. Can you still hear me?
Yes.
Okay. This is the theme, this is the first theme, this is the melodic first theme of the first movement. Characteristic of this is that there is a minor third. Okay?
If I played a major scale, a flat major scale, it would be like this. But when I play the minor scale, it sounds like this. So here we have the minor seventh.
Expressed itself in those forms purely for the pleasure of listening, not dancing, not singing. I will play the first movement without any comments at all, and then the second time I'll play it and talk about the form that he cast the music. It's called Sonato Allegro form that has two themes in the first section. And just like a play has a beginning part where you meet the characters, then in the middle section called the development, the musical action will take place where a composer demonstrates his mastery. And then the last section, the recapitulation, will be a repeat of the first section. But let me play this completely by without comment for the first time, the first movement.
That's not hard. At the introduction.